everyone. Kaylee with Cable Facts. Mike Grab here.
Yes, I'm Mike Grab. Sorry.
We're here with the star of Versailles. This is an Ovation Network series that's going to premiere in October. This is George Blagden.
Hello.
Can I say that
right? Yes, George
Blagden. The very great George, by the way, loved to work on Vikings as well.
Thank you.
This is a very different role for you. But talk about a little bit about the background of how you came to this, first of all. What excited you about it? And obviously, it's pretty cool to be able to shoot in the real Versailles, which both Kaylee and I at different times have been to, and it's amazing. Everyone should try to see it at some point in your life.
You really should.
Yeah.
It was an amazing process getting into it, really. I was shooting season 3 of Vikings when I got the audition through from my team. And very similar to Vikings, it was a show that not really a lot of people knew how to pitch to me. It was being produced in France, but in English for an international market, which Canal Plus had never really done before. And it was 4 weeks away from their production start date to audition to play the lead. So it was kind of a weird experience. And I went and auditioned with my season 3 Vikings look, which involved a high ponytail, shaved buzz cut sides of my head, and a big beard.
A little different.
Not exactly Louis.
Very different
Louis
to this guy. And it was amazing. And it was so close to the wire, and just worked out brilliantly the scheduling that I finished Vikings on a Friday, flew to Paris, France for costume and hair tests and everything on Saturday, and Sunday we rehearsed, and Monday turned over on Versailles. And so I had a weekend between these series and these very different worlds and different characters, and it's a great part of our job being able to do that, you know, as an actor, and being able to kind of jump between these worlds like that. I love it.
Yeah.
The costumes are incredible in this series. And playing Louis XIV, talk a little bit about what it was like to wear layer upon layer of this ornate clothing.
It's incredible, and this goes actually for all departments on the production, that no corners were cut at any point. I mean, anyone watching this is probably in the industry, so they know that part of our world is about pretend, and you know, you create sets, and behind these incredibly elaborate walls are polystyrene blocks. And you know, we didn't do that with Versailles. All of the sets that we created in the studio were exact representations of the rooms in the building, down to the inch. Every single little detail of marble running through the walls and the gilding, and the same with the costumes. We started filming in August 2014, and it was about 30 degrees Celsius. And I was at Versailles in the gardens filming one of our first scenes there, just dripping with sweat. And I said to our costume designer who was there on set that day, I said, I'm wearing 5 layers and you don't see 3 of them. Please, can I take 3 of these off? And she said, no, George, if you take those 3 layers off, the jacket won't sit right.
Right, it won't, right.
And, you know, that was sort of a representation to me of how this production wasn't going to cut any corners.
I mean, did they just have a PA dabbing your forehead every time the camera was
there? The makeup department suddenly hired 3 times the amount of staff that they planned to. No, honestly, it was amazing. And also, you know, I mean, some of the Ovation PR team that are here were visiting the set of season 2 this year and got to see the costume I'm going to describe it as a factory. It is incredible seeing the detail that these guys put into it. I mean, these coats that you can kind of see behind us.
This is what he looks like.
I have five of these overcoats, and each one takes 2 costume staff 3 weeks to embroider, and that's 5 coats. So
wow.
You know, it's.
And you kept all those, right? You just go out to dinner in them now and stuff, right?
No.
Hanging out.
Great Halloween.
Absolutely.
Starting new trends.
Yeah. Oh well, I'd love to, but no, I think they'd find another Louis XIV if they found out I stole costumes.
And this, we should mention also, for those who don't know, this is really the first chance for U.S. markets to see this. Quite a coup for Ovation to get this, because it's been throughout Europe and has actually been very, very well received, and so it's a very exciting thing to see this in the U.S. market. Do you have any sense of how, I mean, do you have a sense of how maybe the U.S. audience will, or how they should look at this, maybe, and how they will maybe look at it differently from European audiences or Asian audiences?
No sense, to be honest, because we've been really surprised in the different territories it's shown at the moment of the reaction. We sort of assumed, we knew that the first territory it would be aired in would be France. That was the deal with Canal Plus when they were selling to foreign territories. And we were all told as a cast that, look, just face it, we've lost this battle already in France because we're representing such an iconic brand of their French history. And whatever we do with this brand, they're going to be unhappy. It aired in France and we had nothing but positive comments and positive critiques on the show and really great ratings, and people seem to start to create this cult fandom that is now kind of coming to light with the show, and that was amazing. And then you know, after that, every territory it's shown in has had a different reaction to this world and this story. So your guess is as good as mine, really, about how the American public will receive it and how they will relate to it. I think it's a great thing about the show is that it covers so much of modern life in this gilded cage, this amazing world. And there's so many elements of modern life that you can find in this show and these people.
How is it a modern story? Relationships?
That's
or?
A good question. Yeah, it's the way that characters behave, how it was documented that events took place and how people interacted socially, that is so incredible. And if you've seen the first few episodes of the show, you'll come across the character of Philippe, the king's brother, Louis's brother, and you know, it's kind of amazing that someone who, a character that modern and that relevant now in 2016.
I think it actually cut out right as you said homosexual crossdresser. I'm wondering if there's some kind of censorship going on here with the internet.
But
no,
you
cut out for 1 second.
Oh, we're back on.
Yeah, we're back
on. Now.
Okay.
We're back.
No, we're on now.
You know, it's
censorship.
Yeah.
Facebook.
I mean, what I would say about the US reception of it is that I guess I've read a little bit in the press about how perhaps Versailles will fill the void that Downton viewers are wanting to fill, Downton Abbey.
Yeah.
I'm going to go ahead now and say that I'm pretty sure people who are fans of Downton Abbey, if they tune into this show, will get quite a shock. Because it's, and that actually represents why this story is so modern, because if we cut forward from history, from this time in history to the 1930s, you can see how conservative we have become as a race. And to think that, you know, in the 20th century, a character like Philippe in Downton Abbey would just not be acceptable.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he would be ostracized, and the fact that he's the second wealthiest and second most powerful man in the world at that time is incredible. And really, it was a building and a world and a microclimate ahead of its time.
And you talked a little bit during the panel about the interesting way that this had to be, or someone on the panel talked about this, how it was shot on Mondays because Precise closed on Mondays, so did you literally have to take, I mean, you had other things you could shoot on the other days, obviously, but just talk a little bit about that. It's an interesting sort of limitation.
Yeah.
That you had less time to shoot things.
Yeah, well, obviously, the Chateau of Versailles is a huge tourist attraction. It welcomes more than, I think, 11 million visitors annually. and to try to shoot a location like that with that footfall is incredibly difficult, but thankfully for us that they close on Mondays, and it meant that we could go in and have full reign of the entire building, which was amazing, and unfortunate really that we started our story at the start of season one where Louis decides to build this palace. So there were a few dream sequences that we feature in the early episodes where we see this dream that Louis has to build this incredible building. So we featured parts of the chateau, and then you realize, well, it's not built in our story yet, so we can't shoot that part of it, we can't shoot that part of it. So we had to use very specific areas of the chateau. But also just the fact that they allowed us into their world, you know, as a group of storytellers who are trying to tell this story that is so dear to the French public and to them, the estate of Versailles, the fact that they said, come on in and you have free reign of this place, was a real affirmation to us that, you know, we were doing this authentically and in an accurate way.
And I think we're almost out of time, but Kayla, you wanted to ask about one scene.
On the panel, you spoke about the lighting changing in a particular moment. Can you tell that story? It was just really captivating.
Yeah, so it was one of our first days shooting at Versailles. And we'd shot outside in the gardens, which are mind-blowing in themselves, so ornate throughout the day. And I knew that at the end of the day, we were going to try to go up to the Hall of Mirrors, this infamous room in the palace, to shoot this monologue that you see in episode one of Louis doing in this dream sequence, describing to his court and the audience to camera of this dream he has of creating this luxurious room. And the way that a lot of people watching this will know, and you guys know, that when you shoot a television show, you can run out of time, especially if you're shooting at a location like this. We had 10 minutes at the end of the day to get this two-page monologue. So we ran up to the Hall of Mirrors. The sun had gone behind the clouds for the last couple of hours, and the light was terrible. I got into my new costume that I had to get in for this speech, and we had about 5-6 minutes left to shoot it, and they thought, well, we'll just do it, come on, get in the middle of this room. And there was this moment of serenity where I was stood in the middle of this room, huge room, that Louis had created as Louis. All of the crew had vacated it because it had to be empty, so it was just the camera and me in this room. And that was where I really realized the enormity of what I'd taken on with this part. And just as they were rolling up the cameras, the sun dipped below the clouds, and it was this completely orange sunset that you only see a couple of times in your life, just bright golden orange light, and it flooded in through the windows just like Louis had designed it to do, and bounce off all of the mirrors and create this room of orange reverberating light. And it's frustrating in a way, because you watch the scene and the camera, even, you know, our really technical camera that we were using to shoot the series, wasn't quite able to capture this detail of light in the air. And it was 4 minutes, we did one take, and it was a kind of magical moment that I'll never forget, where I really felt like the person I was playing was kind of speaking to me in some way. And
that's just nerves
and
of
it
steel.
Was, wasn't it his 200th?
It was on the anniversary of the
that's
300
incredible.
Years since he died. And that's why I love doing this job, is for moments like that. And I'll remember it forever. And I'm sure that, well, I know in season two I've had a lot more moments like that, and I hope if we get to do a third season, I'll have even more moments that I will take to my grave.
Well, great. Well, it airs October 1st, I believe. Is that correct? Yeah, October 1st in the US. So thanks very much, George.
Thank
Appreciate
you.
It.
Thank
George.
You very much.
Great to talk to you.
Yeah.
Thanks, everybody, for watching.